Hi students, as I am in the pinch of health, I hope you are on cloud 9. I am extremely happy to present this video session for you. This is Anthony from Varadasanar Matriculation Higher Secondary School, Arakkonam. This is the continuation of yesterday's class. In the previous video, we had a lengthy discussion about a topic called the poem Our Cashew on a Tree. The first three stanzas we had a discussion, namely, it's just a small recall. The structure of the tree is being taught there, it is very well explained, and the poem is divided into three types, the three parts. First one is a description of the tree. Second one, why the poet liked the tree, why she is tempted towards the tree. The second part is why she wrote this beautiful poem. In the third part, we will see why she wrote this beautiful poem. Now, what are reasons? Various reasons she is going to put down, and the reasons are well accepted by the readers. Next, we are seeing who is Durdat and her family background and how she was interested towards English literature. She lost her elder brother at the age of 14 and her elder sister at the age of 18. She wrote this poem while she is on the bed, while she was counting her days. This beautiful poem, she wrote it. What is the theme of the poem? We should have some theme. The theme of the poem is friendship. First one is friendship. Next, the lost memories of the childhood. The lost memories of the child. These are the two themes that she is going to deal in the five stanzas. So this poem has got five stanzas. Each stanza has got 11 lines. And the rhyming scheme is A, B, B, A. The rhyme scheme is A, B, B, A. This is the rhyme scheme that she followed in this poem. Yes, my dear students. Now, let us move on to the next, the third stanza. In the previous stanza, she talked about the description of the tree, the physical appearance of the tree, and who are the people played there, and what are the birds, what are the animals that we would see on that tree. Everything she explained very well. Now, that was only objective description. Now she is entering into a personal touch towards the poem. She is going to give a kind of personal touch towards the poem. That's what we will see from hereafter. From hereafter, she is going to say why she liked the poem, liked the tree. In what way the tree tempted her. And she is going to say the reasons. See, but not because of its magnificence. Dearer is the cashew nut to my soul. Beneath it, we have played, though years may roll. Oh sweet companions, loud with love intense, for your sake shall the tree be ever dear to me. This is what you ought to note down here, my dear students. This is what, not because of its magnificence. What is this word magnificence? This refers to not because of its size. Not because of his size. Though the tree has grown so tall, sometimes it touches the stars. Not because of the size I like the tree. See, this tree is dearer to me, dearer, very close to me. Yes, cashew nut to my soul. What is the soul? Atma. What do you call it? Soul as Atma. So the tree is like one in my blood, one in my heart, one in my soul. It has become part and parcel of my life. the tree has become. So my dear students, I do not love the tree because of its size. The size, the tree is dearer to me, dearer to my soul, my heart, to my soul, that is my atma, what you call it. Next, beneath it, beneath, the word beneath means under. Under, beneath it, we have played. Who are this we? Yes, the family members. The family members, especially her brother and sister. As I told you, the main theme is the lost childhood memories. We have played though yes may role. The word role means pass. Yes, pass many years, rolled. And one more thing, my dear student. This poem, she wrote not in India. Why she is sitting in India? She wrote somewhere in distance away. She wrote this poem. Sitting somewhere in France, sitting somewhere in Italy, she wrote this poem. She just recalls her childhood memories. That's why I say, it has many years have passed. I have lost my dear brother and sister. Now I am also on the brink of death. I am counting my days. See, we have played though years may roll. So, oh sweet companions, love with love intense, deep love. Intense, the word intense means deep. Thick friendship, what we call it. They are very thick friends. We used to say, some of the people, when you look at them, hey, they are very thick friends, ma. Close relation. Their love is so bounding, we cannot break it. That's what here. Oh, sweet companion, loved with the love, dears. Companions, here, companion refers to a brother and sister. Plus, the friends with whom she played under the tree. See, beneath the tree. It's not only her family members. Here she recalls some of her friends also with whom she played. Loud with loud intents. For your sake shall the tree be ever dear. Whenever I think about the tree, my siblings, they come to my mind. My friends are coming to my mind. I can recall those moments. Whenever I think about my friends, the tree is coming to my mind. So dear to me. They are very close to me. Tree has become part and parcel of her life. It is one in her blood as well as in her soul. So these lines talks about not she liked the tree not because of its the beauty. It's not because of beauty or its size. Mainly the tree was dearer to her, so close to her, because under the tree they have played. Under the tree they share, they experience everything. Though they are no more with her, but she is recalling those memories. That's why she says, I like the tree very much. I like the tree very much because we experienced, we shared everything under the tree. Yes, dear students, blend with your image, you shall arise in memory, till the hot tears blind mine eyes. What is the trench? Like a murmur that I hear, like the sea breaking the shingles beach. Is it the tree's lament and error speech that happy to the unknown land may reach? My dear students, here she is just explaining, giving reason why she liked the tree. Blent, the word blent means, the word blent means here mix, mixing. Blend with the image, it shall arise, it has come out in memory till the hot tears blend my eyes. Yes, when eyes filled with tears, eyes filled with tears, there also I could remember my childhood experiences. In memory I could recall those days when my eyes were filled with tears. What is the trench like a murmur that I hear? What is the sound that I hear? Though I am living so far away, distant lands, still I would hear a murmuring sound, a humming sound. Where it comes? Is it from the sea? See next line. Is it different? Like a sea breaking on the shingle. In India, we will see, like, if especially we go to Marina Beach, we will see sand beach. It is a sand beach. What do you call it? The shingle beach. Shingle beach is like a bubbles. I'm talking about Kurangal, where lots of okay, ba. Shingle we will find in Italy and France. So she just, though she stays somewhere distant land, still she says like a sea breaking a shingle beach. It is a tree lament. What do you mean by the word lament? Cry. The word lament. I could see, I could hear some sound. It's not from the sea, but still in the night I could hear a murmuring sound, a humming sound. What is that sound? Sounds like a cry, a lament. Airy speech. What is that airy? Airy. Strange. Strange speech, strange sound, unknown sound. First time I am hearing a strange sound I could hear. That happily to the unknown land may reach. Yes, unknown land. Unknown land means normally what we call the real meaning for the word unknown is a land of devils, they say. A land of devil. We don't know where it is. We can say land of heaven. We don't know where it is. But they say it is unknown land. Here in this poem, she has used the word unknown. Unknown land means she is staying some far away from her native. From her native place, she is saying. That's why the word is used here, the particular word unknown. See, in this stanza, she talks about, she explains about various reasons why she liked the tree. It's not because of its size, it's not because of its beauty. Mainly, we played under the tree. We experienced love and friendship there. Now, I could recall those moments in my life. Still, though I am living somewhere far away from my native place, I could hear the feelings, the emotions of the tree. How I could hear the feelings and emotions of the tree? It is only by its cry. See, the poet's imagination, how she used those words. Tree never cries. Yes, tree never cries. Tree never laughs. But the poet, he uses different words. Here she says, since we are not there, the tree is just lamenting, crying, plumble, alugai. Yes, for our presence, my brother is no more, my sister is no more, I don't know where are my friends. But I could hear the lament of the tree, the cry of the tree, the murmuring sound of the tree. This is what explained in the particular stanza. Yes, my dear students, coming to the next stanza. Unknown, yet well known to the eye of faith. I have heard that wail far, far away. In distant lands by many sheltered bay, when slumbered in his cave the water wraith, and waves gently kiss the classic shore of France, Italy beneath the moon. When earth lay tranced a dreamless swan, and every time the mist grows before, mine is a vision, rose a form of sublime. Thy form, O tree, as in my happy prime, I saw thee in my own loud native clime. Yes, my dear students, as I told you, most of the meanings I already explained to you, and some of the glossary that I have given here, wail. Wail means just a cry. Pulambal, alugai. Okay, va. Bay, inlet of the sea. Wraith, ghost like image. Wraith, word here, listen here. Water wraith. What is this water wraith? Water wraith. Even the god of water also cries. Even the god of water just listens the voice of the tree, the lament of the tree. See the imagination of the poet. The real word wraith means it's like a apparition, ghost, like apparition, images. But here the poet has used a particular word, water wraith. We got to read it together, water wraith, then only it gives a clear meaning, god of water. Those who take deep sleep, those who go to take deep sleep, even they go to hear this murmuring sound. Though I am living in unknown yet well known to the eyes of faith. What is the eyes of faith? Eyes of faith, nambikai. This is what. Those who believe in only that, they go to hear the sound of the tree. They go to hear the cry of the tree. I have heard that a whale cry, as I slowly whale cry, shore water near the land. Next, swoon, faint, tranced, unconscious, where we lose ourselves, unconscious, sublime, beautiful, slumbered, deep sleep. This word is sublime, good qualities. The word sublime means good qualities. The good qualities that we have. Thy form, thy refers to the tree. Thy means refers to tree. It refers to tree. Yes, your size. Next, O tree, as in my happy prime. What is the meaning for the word prime? The word prime refers to a childhood memories. Childhood memories. I saw you. Yes, when I was a child, I saw you in my own loud native clime. Clime means refers to a native place. See, though she lives far away, she talks about this beautiful tree, which is no more to her, which is no more nearer to her. Though she lives in Italy or in France, still she would see, she would hear the cry of the tree. So these are the vocabulary or gloss that we ought to learn. It will come for you in the appreciation question. They will ask you, what is this? What is, for example, what do you mean by the word slumbered? What is the wreath? They will ask such questions. Kindly note down this glossaries. The last stanza, coming to the last stanza, therefore, I fain would consecrate a lay unto thy honor tree, beloved of those who now in blessed sleep for a repose, dearer than life to me, alas, were they? Mayest thou be numbered when my days are done, with deathless trees like those in Borrowdale. Yes, my dear students. Therefore, I fain. What do you mean by the word fain? Happy. We can use the word happy. Gladly, happily. I want to consecrate. What do you mean by the word consecrate? I want to make it holy, sacred. Abhishegam seyirudhu. Okay, abhishegam. Kumbhabhishegam solran pora. Same word is used here. So, I want to consecrate. The word consecrate means I want to make it holy. What she wants to make it holy? The tree. She wants to give immortal life for the tree. The tree should not die. Even I die also, the tree should be talked by many people. That's what consecrated lay. Lay means refers to layman. We are laymen. Especially those who are in the church, those who are in the temple, they are the people called priests. Those people are not laymen. We are the layman. Common man, the public. So, consecrate a lay. I want to consecrate the tree. I want to consecrate. I want to make it holy. I want to give a immortality to the tree. Next, unto thy honor. Honor. The word honor refers to respect. Respect. I want to give respect. Trees. Beloved of those who now blessed sleep for a repose. Blessed sleep, my dear students, it's not just a sleep. Blessed sleep refers to death. It refers to death. My brother, my sister is no more. They are gone to take a blessed sleep. Eternal rest. Eternal rest. They are taking eternal rest. They are no more. Repose, deep sleep. Repose, it refers to a deep sleep. It refers to deep sleep. They are no more. See, still I want to consecrate.
dearer than life to me. Yes, this tree is so close to me. So close to me. Alas, where are they?
They refers to her siblings as well as her friends. Mayest thou be numbered when my days are done. See this phrase. When my days are done means I am counting my days. I am on the brink of death. As she is affected by tuberculosis. She is just counting her days. That's what I am. My days are counted. With deathless trees like those in Borrowdale. This is the reference that she has taken from William Wordsworth. Okay, wow. There the poet talks about a tree called yew tree. Yew tree which he immortalized in the particular poem. William Wordsworth in Borrowdale, he just consecrated. Okay, consecrated tree called yew. In the same manner, those that wanted to consecrate, immortalize this tree. What the tree means? Cashew tree. She wanted to give a long life for the tree. As William Wordsworth has done in Borrowdale, the tree is called yew tree. Same manner she wanted to consecrate here. See, my dear students, being a layman, being a common man, she wanted to give a kind of consecration, kind of respect, make it holy, or give a long life, immortal life to the tree. Though her friends, her siblings are no more. But she says, tree is dearer to me, close to me. Okay, ma'am. Now, she tries to give immortality to the tree in this particular poetic lines.
Under whose awful branches lingered pale, fear, trembling hope, and death, the skeleton, and time, the shadow, and though weak the verse, that would thy beauty feign, oh, feign rigors, may love defend thee from oblivion curse.
Yes, my dear students, having come to the end of the poem, here she talks about death. She's going to personify how the death is going to approach her, how the death is going to take her away. See, these words all synonymous with the word called death, namely lingered, pale, fear, trembling, hope. Next, death, the skeleton. These are the words lingered or synonymous with the word called death.
She's just explaining what kind of death she is going to face in her life. What kind of death?
We all are. As we are born in the world, one day we got to face a death. We not know when it comes, how it comes. But it will go. It will come one time. But she says, fear, I have got a fear. I am afraid of death.
Trembling hope. What is the trembling hope?
Shivering. I am shivering. Next, death, the skeleton, the time shadow, it is approaching me. The time is coming very close to me. Like a shadow, it is following me. And though weak words, I am unable to write clearly. My words are very weak. I am not getting proper words. The letters, everything I am not getting, though the words are weak. That would thy beauty, thy means it refers to tree. I like the tree because of its beauty. Fain it goes away. Fain rigors, it may be a rehearsal. It may be a small rigorous practice for me. May love defend thee from oblivion curse.
Oblivion, the word oblivion means, as given here, oblivion, state of forgetfulness. Curse, sabam, curse na sabam. Yes, my dear students, she says, by all means, okay, ba, I should not forget the tree in my life. I wanted to consecrate this tree, okay, ba, so that it goes, it lives forever and ever. Having come to the end of the poem, just have a recall. Let's recall the main theme. The main theme of the poem is friendship and lost childhood memories. These two things should be remembered. Friendship and the second one is the lost childhood memories. The poem is, as I told you, is divided into three parts. First one, the description of the tree. Second one, why I like the tree. Third part, it is why I wrote this beautiful poem. At the end of the poem, we will see how these poets wanted to consecrate, okay, make it holy or give immortal life to this beautiful tree, Cashewnut tree. She wrote this poem in 1881. She wrote this poem in 1881. This poem is taken from the miscellaneous poems, collection of poems. From there only this beautiful poem is taken. Okay, with this we have come to the conclusion, and I hope students, you will write down all the appreciations separately and the ERC and the paragraph that is sent to you. Write everything in subject note and do read it well, because through reading this poem, your imagination, your fantasy world will increase in your life. You also can become, tomorrow you also can become a poet, or poet or poetess. Okay, love the nature. Love the nature. The colors are the beautiful smiles. The colors are the beautiful smiles. Look at the nature and love. Never destroy the nature, rather save nature. Save nature. Thank you very much. Thank you.